Okay, so this video is about bicycle bodywork. Now, not all bicycles have bodywork, but our kind of bicycles often do. I've shown you the state of this chain case that was on the Electra. I've shown you that already in an earlier video. And I'm out here this evening doing some repairs to it, some basically body repairs, same as the car body repairs. And I just thought I'd let you see what I'm doing. Now, what we've got, when the flap wheel has taken the paint off, I've sanded that down and it's reasonably feathered there. It still needs to be sanded a little finer yet. But before I do that, you see the texture of the metal. This isn't just surface rust, this is corrosion that's gone inside. And they're all tiny little pits all over there. So when I do it, when I spray the primer and the paint on, unless I spray about 20 coats of high build primer, that's going to show through and be rough. And this stuff, the surface kind of rust, that'll sand down adequately, but these pits need attention. Rather than get out a load of body filler, this is the stuff that we tend to use, sometimes called stopper. I grew up with it being called stopper. I've been doing this since the back end of the 1960s, early 1970s, when I was 9, 10, 11. My uncle had a body shop specialised in vintage cars, and I was kind of an informal Saturday apprentice. I absolutely loved it. Still think I should have done it for a living. So I'm going to show you how to put that on. I'm just showing you what I've done so far. Looks a mess. It's fine that it looks a mess because it's going to be sanded down. The idea is that this is sanded down so far that all you see where these dark chips are will be grey dots, and the rest will be the original metal. So this is not like a body filler where you build anything up. This is specifically for filling in imperfections. And the really bad pieces down here, I really should have shown you this before, but I was getting on with it when I decided to make this video, so I apologize for not showing you right from the start. I'm going to show you putting it on in a minute, but this is how the rest is looking. So now let's have a go at this. I'm going to see if I can manage to do it with one hand. Bear with me a second. Right, now I've squeezed some putty out and put it onto the knife. You can use something like a credit card. This old butter knife has a perfectly straight top edge on it, and it's just it's a tool that I've used so much I'm just familiar with it, so it's what I'm going to use. And then the idea is, excuse me again as I move that round, this area that's pitted here, we will, God, I'm using my wrong hand as well, it's really difficult. Scrape it on, it looks as though I'm scraping it on lightly. The idea is to really push it in. Be quite firm. Push that in really firmly. Because we want the filler to go into all these little pits. Doesn't matter what it does on the top surface, that's going to be sanded off again. We want it to go into the pits. So where those pits are, it can go in. I'll just put a little blob on there. And then use the knife to spread it in. Firmly down, squash it into the pits, and whatever's on the top surface can now just be given a light, only light now, run over with the knife just to level it off, so it's less to have to sand afterwards. And now, if you want to, you can do this, you're not supposed to, but personally I use my finger. I'm just working that now into some of this pitted area. This is probably doing it a little too fine for a piece that's going to be at the back of the chain case. This will go on the driver's side, this will go there. So it's right down underneath the bike. I'm doing it this fine because I wasn't on the ball enough to show you how to do it on the more prominent parts. I wouldn't normally do it on this back bit. I'm just working that in, making sure it's adhered inside of those pits. A little bit of pressure there just to work it in. And a little rub over the surface. I can feel it starting to go off already. We're in a moderate temperature, it's not hot or anything. So the setting time does vary according to temperature. And that looks a horrible mess, but it doesn't matter because it's going to be sanded down. This was done 15 minutes ago and it's definitely hardening now. You can see I've put this on a little bit smoother. These ridges here, it's at a nice, you can do this as a little bit of a cheat as it's getting to the point where it's getting, it's beginning to go off, it's getting a bit of crumble to it. If you're light fingered, you can just give it a little rub over and get some of these ridges off to give yourself less to sand. But do not press on at all, otherwise you'll end up pulling it out of the pit that you've got it in. Just a little tickle like that. I'm just smoothing down those ridges a little bit, just to give myself less sanding later. This was the first piece to be done and this is now hardening off quite nicely. Knock off some of those little points with my hands, with my fingers. Little feel over for any other point. There's a bit of a ridge there that can be flattened out somewhat. And see, for this piece in here, this line in here we call the swage line on the car, I just put the filler on the end of my finger and just rubbed it up. But the important thing is this area was terribly, terribly pitted. It's the worst bit on the whole bike. So those pits are now filled. I will sand it back and I'll show you when it's been sanded back how all you really see is the pits filled up with filler and the tiniest skim of filler over the rest of it. And then when we put this primer on, it'll look like we've never been there. Right, so the stopper dried. I brought it out here with a bowl of tepid washing up water. It's just washing up liquid, but any soap will do. It's important to have some lubricant in the water. The soapy water just helps the grit cut. It lubricates the cut. When you're sanding something, you're making thousands and thousands of tiny scratches. And having some soapy water rather than plain water just helps to lubricate the process better, stop it dragging. And another thing about the massive tiny scratches, try not to just go one way when you're sanding. Try and swirl or go two different directions. That way you'll get a smoother surface. You won't just get scratches going in one direction. Now I'm just finishing off doing this section, so I'm trying to do one-handed. I'm going to hold it with my knee so I can hold the phone. I'm just finishing off the last of this. You can see how little is left compared to how much I put on. Move that piece out of the way. Checking it with my finger all the time, you'll find that you end up with a hump in the middle and the edges will start to feel smooth, but there'll still be a hump up in the middle. And the parts that you haven't touched, like there, you'll feel a little ridge. So that's what I'm going to take out now. And you just got to keep going. It happens slowly, so you just have to keep at it. Because you see the size, the area disappear. And we gradually get left with just the pits filled. You see all these little white dots? These are all the rusty pits that are now filled. That was a whole pitted area. I'm just going to take that down a little bit flatter so it looks more like that. And these bits I've already done, and you can see that most of what I put on has been taken off again. And the inside section, this is the section you saw me fill the other night. Again, nearly all gone. There's just white dots, and there were the pits. And then a few little pitted areas. You can see this piece particularly, there is a rusty pit there with a little bit of rough area around it. I think that's I'm not quite happy with that edge. I might go over that edge again. And you see this needs some fine sanding on the edge of that paint. See where the flap wheel has left marks? Don't want anything like that either. So part of the sanding process, we'll be taking that out. I'm using these blocks, these Formy blocks. They're ideal for contoured surfaces like this. I would sometimes use a sheet just on the end of my finger to get into the little screwy areas. Large flat surfaces, I would use a sheet wrapped around a block or use a machine. But really anywhere on a bicycle, you're better off with these little foamy sanders. And you can see I haven't done this at all. So take a look at it now, and then you can take a look at it later when I've gone over and sanded the whole lot. And see how little is left of what's on there. Right, time to get on. Yeah, that's reducing now, that's getting smooth. There's a little bump there. Let's get that down now. And the trickier part is going into this swage line. And then there's a bit of paint left there as well. That's got a rough edge. So I'm going to take the paint. Down to a smooth edge as well. You will find, as you do this, you will find that you discover new places that you've missed. I found a place up here. This is rough here, and I actually took a little flake off with my fingernail. I completely missed that. These jobs never go according to schedule, so set yourself plenty of time to do it, and when you find these bits, just take your time and go through them one by one. There's another issue with this chain guard. You see these nice graphics? You can't get these anymore, and that is why I've gone very close to the graphics but not gone into them. There is some loose paint here. If I was to just flick that off, that would take the graphic with it. So there's a trick that I'm going to do. I shall put a ruler against this straight line, run a scalpel or craft knife along there to cut off that paint at the edge of the line to stop the flakes going under the line. Then the paint can just disappear then. And I'll use the edge of the line as my paint edge. If there is anything loose still under the graphic, then I'm just going to feed a bob of super glue underneath there just to stabilise that. And then mask to the edges of the lines all the way along and mask around the Amsterdam transfer there, which you'll see me do later on. You see there's all these parts as well. See how I've gone up to the line but not over it, and down here ditto. So it's going to be an interesting masking job, this one. See there, that is just going to have to be sacrificed, that bottom little bit of pinstriping. But unfortunately you can't get these striping sets. Otherwise I would have got a set in the white or silver and done the bike in a different colour. What you doing, Cassie? Hello. What you doing? A very backlit Cassie. Right. Now what's he doing? What I'm doing actually is just heating the metal up. Not too much, don't overdo it. Warming the metal up, and then I'll just stand these to dry when they're nice and warm. because we need to drive out every little bit of moisture before we start putting the primer on.